Welcome to For the Record, an unfiltered view on current trends and timeless advice for surviving in the aesthetics industry. Whether you're an injector, practice owner, sales rep, or marketer, it's time to set the record straight. Each week, we cut through the chaos and showcase diverse perspectives and winning ideas from the best minds in the industry. I'm your host, Dr. Tiffany Hall, Chief Growth Officer at Aesthetic Record. Now, let's get started on this week's episode. Hey guys, welcome back to another week of For the Record. And today we have a guest from sunny Miami, Florida. We have Dr. Shaun Patel, who is the founder of Miami Skin and Vein, which is a pretty large clinic in Miami where he is the sole injector, but building a booming business. And he has done this on his own as a startup. He is a Harvard-trained interventional radiologist turned aesthetic ninja. And we're going to hear today all about his successes, pursuits, trials, and obstacles as an aesthetics physician and a business owner. So, Dr. Patel, welcome to our podcast.
Well, thank you for that kind introduction. I'm looking forward to this.
Well, we met, what, 3-4 years ago through Gain. You were a Gain trainer. I think your first year on Gain, I actually had met you, and we kind of brought you on. And so you piqued my interest then because you had a really just unique story and kind of this whole Miami thing. I think it's a very competitive market. And you are succeeding in a big way. So tell us how a radiologist ended up in aesthetics, because that's a pretty big jump. Give us the lowdown.
Yeah, it is a pretty big jump. Probably I started this clinic about 8 years ago. The name is Miami Skin and Vein, and I was an interventional radiologist, and I decided that, you know, I didn't want to work in a hospital. I didn't want to be in a dark room. I didn't want to be exposed to radiation, and I figured that all out pretty late in the game. And so one of my med school roommates, we kind of teamed up and we decided that we wanted to open a vein practice. And that was something that I knew a little bit about because I had a background in interventional radiology and we treat vascular disorders. So it could go out a year, we open up Miami Vein and Laser Institute was the original name. And the idea was we were gonna treat venous disease, sclerotherapy, varicose veins and the sort. And we opened up and my job was mainly clinical, and my friend was the one running the clinic and helping out a little bit clinically as well. Jump a couple of months and I realized that I really liked doing some of the procedures that we were offering, sclerotherapy, varicose vein treatment, and what patients kept asking me, a lot of it was cosmetic. They're coming in because they don't like how the veins on their legs look. And so I started realizing that there was a real big potential for aesthetics. And we had some lasers that we used on the lower extremities to treat veins. And patients started asking me if I would treat things on other parts of the body, including their face. Started doing a little bit of a rosacea treatment on the face, telangiectasias on the face. And before you knew it, it started becoming, well, can you do anything for these lines and can you do anything for these wrinkles? We bought another laser. At that time, we bought a Fraxel. And that was where my aesthetic journey began. We had an XLV from Cutera, which was a vascular 532-1064 YAG laser. And I had a Fraxel dual and started doing aesthetic treatments. We have a lot of patients in Miami, of course, with sun damage. To Botox and injectable fillers. And what I realized at that point was I loved injectables even more than I loved devices. And lots of learning. And years later, I guess I could consider myself very comfortable with injectables, kind of an expert almost in these treatments. And it's what I do 80% of the time in my clinic. So I'm seeing patients, I work 5 days a week, 80% of the time doing injectables. I still do lasers and a lot of skincare. I have no vein in my practice anymore. So the vein is gone and it's mainly an aesthetic clinic here in Miami.
But you're grateful for the veins. They got you there, right? That was a conduit.
I'm grateful for the veins, and I guess your guys are going to ask me, some of your readers may be thinking why the place is still called Miami Skin and Vein. And I've just been told by the marketing people that Miami Skin and Vein is stuck in Google and in the digital space. And so to keep the name because, it gets me a lot of exposure.
You know, that's so true. We talk a lot about even your domain name. like to totally go off topic from the very beginning, like buying a domain, like if you want to start your practice, you have to look and see, can Google even give you that domain name? If the answer is no, you can't name it that. Like, I'm so sorry, but you can't. You can't have, you know, what if Charmin didn't have Charmin? It wouldn't be Charmin anymore, like the toilet paper brand. You have to have the domain name or you can't exist.
Absolutely. And you got to get that name right pretty early on, because there's almost, Google looks at how long you've had the domain and how, and so now I've got about a decade on MiamiSkinAndVein.com. And it's very hard. It would take me another decade to get that kind of with another domain. So that's what I learned. Who would have thought that that name was going to be so important going forward? But that digital footprint is one of the most important things to getting new patients into your practice these days. You know, the more Google points towards you, the more patients you get. Of course, social media is becoming very helpful as well. But really, you nail it when you get Google right and you get social media right.
Well, it's funny that you say that, because I was on your website last night and this morning, and you've done a ton of blogging. We had Cameron Hemphill on a few weeks ago talking about blogging, and you've got a ton of blogs. I saw you had a contour blog that was obviously very recent, which is how you stuff a lot of keywords for Google. Google loves a good blog, right? They crawl that site, and it's like carpe diem on the keywords.
What I've learned about Google is, and then I'll tell you what I've learned about patients as well. Google loves keywords. Google loves content. Google loves original content. And patients love education. Okay, patients want to learn. A lot of times they don't know what they want, but they know what bothers them. And you can really steer the conversation using digital. Before patients come into my practice, most of them kind of know what to expect. I've had patients come in for Kybella, and I get into the room and they say, are you gonna put on that grid? Right away, that they've seen something online, they've watched the procedure. And I said, did you watch my video? And I said, yeah, they'll say, yeah. So almost every procedure I do, there's a video, and we don't cut, we edit slightly, but we're really trying to show the procedure in whole on our website. So you go to our YouTube channel, you go to our Instagram, now with Instagram TV, you can put the whole clip up. And we don't cut out the bleeding, we don't cut out the cannula entry point. I want them to see what the procedure is about. You can put a little clip in. We started recently putting a clip in at the end with the patient telling them how it felt, and then I remind patients that although it looks like it hurts a lot, you can see it doesn't really hurt that much. But patients appreciate that, and we get patients from all over the country. We get patients from all over the country, and I'm in Miami, so we get a lot of patients from Latin America, the Caribbean, and a lot of it is because of social media and Google and our videos, and patients get to know my personality. A lot of times they get to know the staff in these videos. And so that's really kind of, it used to be, I guess, before my time, the way you made a name for yourself was being on podium, being on stage, publishing lots of papers, and paying lots for print advertising. Today it's much, much easier. It doesn't cost too much to create content and disseminate it. All I need is a Saturday morning to write a good one or two blog posts. Video editing, my wife does my video editing. And now that my wife's a little bit busier, she's taught one of the MAs in the practice to do some of the video editing. And I've just gotten very good at knowing exactly where to stop and what they want in a clip to make it easy to put together an iMovie. We don't have a big advertising budget. We don't have a big marketing budget. I don't have a big following on Instagram. I have about 6,000 followers on Instagram, but we make it a point of making sure all of our patients follow us on Instagram. And one of the things I've learned is I used to use, when I started the practice, and this was before I had a social media presence, we had MailChimp and we would send out email blasts. And every time I sent out an email blast, I'd look at how many people unsubscribed. And of course, it always hurt my feelings when people subscribe. But I learned that if you sent them an email blast too often, the unsubscribe rates would go up really high. But what Instagram is if you can get your patients to follow you on Instagram, it's like sending them a MailChimp email every day. And they're not going to unsubscribe from you. They're not going to unsubscribe from you. So I could talk about everything, and we can redirect things in the clinic. I remember we have these clinic goals, and one year, one of our clinic goals was to really work on neurotoxin retention, get as many patients as we can into the clinic for retreatment every 3 months. And a big part of that campaign was, we had set up recalls in our clinic, and staff routinely called patients to remind them of the treatments. But we also had an associated social media campaign where we would post like the staff getting their treatments done, and all it would be is a gentle reminder to get your Botox or get your Dysport, call and schedule today. And so you can really direct these kind of campaigns, and this doesn't cost any money. This doesn't cost any money. So I think almost anybody can run a successful business, get patients. Then, the hard part is, not getting the patient, but delivering a good result, a good experience consistently. And that means not just the treatment, but the front office experience, the follow-up. We send patients a message the day after checking up on them. They have access to me. We use this communication platform, Clara. I don't know if you've heard of it, Tiffany. Patients fill out all their forms electronically on Clara. They communicate with us, the staff, from 9 to 5. The staff check it. After hours, I get the Claras on my phone. And so patients always have access to us. And I think that's one of the big things. I would never want one of my patients to have a complication and end up in the ER, and the ER doctor doesn't know what the heck a filler is. I'd much rather screen that before the patient gets to the ER, or if I need to, join the patient in the ER.
You just unpacked a lot of things there, Dr. Patel. That was a lot of stuff. I got to think through how to respond to all that. But I think what you said about Instagram, you and I have talked about, core versus non-core a lot. That's been a hot topic for many, many years. And people want to know, what is this rise in non-core mid-levels? And I think a lot of it is Instagram. To your point before now, to become a famous injector, you need to be core. Or to even get patients in, you need to be a plastic or a derm, because they're going to come to you anyway for other procedures. You need to be doing research, be on podium. And I think now we've sort of decentralized that whole thing with Instagram, because I can fall in love with you as a person, about your practice, the fun that you guys have on TikTok, all these things, and decide to come and engage with you without having ever seen you do research, right? Patients don't know what research is. They have no idea about PRS or JCAD. They like the fact that you are fun and your videos are good and that you have great results. I think the buying schema for a patient is much different than being famous in the industry. It's, there's a famous injector, Andreas Nicholas, who is in Canada, coming to Aesthetic Next, who is arguably one of the best in the entire world, drop dead, hands down, fantastic. But he has a very small Instagram following. And so in the U.S., who is that guy? Around the world, where they don't have this Instagram obsession, he is crazy famous. In the U.S., they're like, never heard of him before. Tiff, who is he? I'm like, really? It's like we live and die here on Instagram. So it's, as a physician, it has to be a little bit maddening to say, I've got great skills, but if my Instagram following isn't high, I can't get patients. It has to be a little bit maddening for you, having gone through, 50 years of medical school and fellowships and all these things.
It does, but it's not so maddening to me, because it really gives a lot of us opportunity as well. In the old system, just because you did research, maybe you didn't have the right relationships with vendors, maybe you weren't on the right research projects, it was tough to get your name out there. But today, for very little, almost anybody can do it. And it doesn't mean that people who make their name on Instagram or social media are not as good injectors. You still got to prove yourself. You've got to produce good content. You've got to have good reviews. You've got to have good results, before and after photos. You look at these Instagram productions, it's not any easier than giving lectures all over the country. It's a full-time job creating that content. I've had to do it. And I see some of these other, even younger injectors, who are posting 2-3 times a day, have these really complex stories, producing reels, and it's mind-boggling to me, because even me, just to get one post out a day, a good quality post with an educational text, it takes a lot of thinking. It takes a lot of thinking, and you can't just put a post out about frown lines every day. You got to really get them interested. You got to teach them something they don't know. you got to show them a different technique. So I think social media, it's been actually really helpful for my practice. Really helpful. I can direct the conversation in my practices and in my practice and in my consultations. This year, one of our goals is to focus more on body work, and we're able to drive that conversation using social media. A couple of years ago, one of my focuses was the neck. We do so much for the face. How do we extend the focus, grow, you know, start focusing on the neck? So a lot of our content was about the treatment options that we have on the neck. And up until then, a lot of my patients thought the only options for the neck were surgical.
Oh yeah, I think it's a great tool.
What were the old ways of getting the word out? Billboards and newspapers and high-end magazines, those views don't even touch what a good social media campaign can get you. And by campaign, nothing structured, it's just doing good work on social media.
Well, I think too, if you have a good website, you have pay-per-click or Google AdWords, you know, all of a sudden it's like the triumvirate. If you have social media, you've got websites, you have Google clicks, you know, you're crushing the game. But
that's a key, multi-channel. And you know it because you run a business, Tiffany, but that's what it is. You've got to be good at all of them. You don't have to be, you know, you don't have to be Dr. K on Instagram. Like, I mean, you know, I have maybe 2% of the followers she has. But Instagram is a big space for me. But it's a combination of Instagram and YouTube and the website that really help us. And then doing good internal marketing as well, making sure your patients know what treatments you offer, making sure that your patients know the follow-up, but the plan, creating a plan for them. They come in for lips and not just talking to them about lips, but educating them on all the things that we can do today. The technology is advancing almost monthly, you know, like, you know, I had patients that last month when contour came out, I'm introducing them to contour, and I'm like, you know, this is like the fifth filler, a new cheek filler in the time that we've known each other from my practice. And why is this different? But educate them on that. And it's very exciting. It's very exciting. It's a really exciting time to be in aesthetics, both on the injectables front and the device front.
You know, it's funny that you mentioned Dr. K. I was actually editing a video of hers last night for some things to do with her. And she talks about, you know, to fellow injectors to say, we need to be the tour guide for the patient. You know, don't let them leave your practice today without saying, the next time that you come in, we're going to do this. Because then patients feel like a commitment to coming back to you because they know what you're going to do next. Like, we should agree upon the next visit so that they come back. Yeah, I think about her retention strategies. By the way, she's a machine. For those of you who don't know it, she's a freaking machine to watch her on video. It's insane.
I can tell she's a machine. I met her a few times at meetings, and you can tell her energy and her drive. But you can tell that on social media too. You get to know the person without actually meeting the person on social media. When they're putting enough content out there, you really get a sense of her personality. Yeah, I think, Tiffany, you made a good point. Education for the patient is the most important part. And I think something that I kind of fell into, but something that I loved early on, in radiology, one of the problems was, one of the things I didn't like is you don't get interaction with patients, really. You know, you're reading their images, you're treating them when they're sedated, but you're not really getting to interact with them. So I really had a blast when I got into aesthetics, and I had time to spend with my patients. Particularly when you're starting out your practice, I train a lot of newer injectors. I always tell them, when you're starting out and building your practice, you know, you have a lot of time. You're not as busy as you are in a couple of years after you open your practice. And so you really got to nail it right when you open. No excuses. You got to deliver a perfect result. You got to deliver a perfect on-time experience. You've got to give them a detailed and thorough consultation. You've got to follow up with them personally. I used to follow up with them on my cell phone personally. But when you're starting out your practice, that's how you do it. Now, eventually, that became a problem because there were a lot of patients out there with my phone number, and I got busy enough that suddenly they're texting me to get an appointment or to ask me about a treatment. And I'm not able to respond quickly enough, because we grew relatively fast. But you got to do that at the beginning. People talk about, I don't have time to ask for reviews. Well, when you're starting out, you definitely have time to ask for reviews. I don't have time to talk about skincare. Well, you definitely have time to talk about skincare when you're starting out. They come in for lips on a busy, busy day, and it's a new consult and it's lips, and you feel tempted to just do the lips and keep them happy, but you gotta take the time to talk to them about the cheeks and to talk to them about the laugh lines and to talk to them about what Dysport can do for your skin and to talk about what we can do for your jawline and to talk about the importance of sunscreen and sun protection and eating healthy and sleeping well. So if you don't do all of that, then you're going to have a lip patient. If you do a good job with the lips, you're going to have a lip patient for life. But if you do all of that, you're going to have every 3 months a neurotoxin in the upper face, a neurotoxin in the masseters, a neurotoxin in the neck. You're going to have fillers in the upper face, the mid face, the lower face. You're going to have a series of IPLs every year, and they're going to be buying a bunch of skincare every 2 months. And that's how I learned. I'd rather see fewer patients who follow the full plan than a ton of patients who don't really do much of the plan, you know? I hate seeing before and afters of beautiful lips, and then you see that the face is squared off or the skin quality around the mouth is very poor. And you feel like, man, that was the last thing the patient needed. I'm sure it was the first thing she asked for, but the last thing she needed. And it's our job to educate the patient on that.
I think that's also the risk when you're starting out, is because you're so desperate for patients when you're new that you'll do, if they said, I want more, you're like, you know what? I need to sell syringes. You can have more. Like, I think there is a risk, but to your point, when I was a sales rep, I used to always say this to my accounts. It's like when you go to the mechanic and you say, I think I have a flat tire, and they fix it. And then you go down the street and your engine falls out. Well, I was just at the mechanic. How come no one told me? Because you didn't ask about that. You asked about your tire. It's like, that's what when we just do lips and their cheeks are falling down to their nipples, it's like, you missed the big sign here, guys, that we have no cheeks, our forehead, whatever. I think it reminds me of that same idea of like, well, I didn't tell you that you were about to have your car explode because you asked about the chip in your windshield. And I didn't think you cared about the fact that you were going to die, you know? Like, I like to put things in extreme metaphors. It helps people to learn. But I think to your point, what you do in the beginning sets the tone for everything. I'm in a similar boat that you're in, that when I first came to AR, it was still, you know, a quite small company. And I gave my cell phone out to everyone. My cell phone is still in my email, which is a terrible mistake to make. I get text messages 24 hours a day. Can you fix this? You know, my system, can you do this? No, I have not been on customer support in this company for years. I'm not the person to call because I'm not going to do a good job for you. Call the person who's doing that all day long, who can look at your problem and immediately give you the answer. Could I give it to you? Yes. But it's going to take me 4 hours and 16 things I've got to cancel on to get you your answer. So it's like, I get your point. But what I did in the beginning was I gave that as my platform. And now people are like, well, how come it's not like that anymore? Well, because we grew. So I think it's the risk that, you know, that you're facing.
And I got that at a certain point too, from some patients that I liked it when you mm-hmm. used to be the next day instead of. And we got to a point now that I have the staff call them, and we got to a point where we automated it through Clara. It's not completely automated, but they have to click something and the patient gets a message just checking up on them, and they can reply and they're answering back. And if it's something that I need to see, they just tag me on the message and I reply back as well. But I thought that was really important. To getting the practice started. When you're starting out, you have the time to do that. You have to accommodate the patients. That's how you also build up your reviews and your digital experience. When you're spending that kind of time, you have to really explain to a patient, can you please leave a review on the internet for me? And actually explain to them why it will help. So in our staff meetings, these days I'm getting shuffled around from room to room, constantly find myself behind like today. And so I don't get a chance to ask these things the way I would like to. And my father is in the hotel business. And so I learned the importance of the digital presence and reviews very early on, because way before Google reviews and Yelp reviews and Real Self reviews for aesthetics, there was TripAdvisor for the hotel industry. And at that time, when my father was first exposed to TripAdvisor, they control the market. If you didn't have good TripAdvisor reviews, you didn't get internet booking. And so one of the things that he taught his staff was this very simple rule, which I still to this day teach my You can ask a patient for a review, and you probably, the chances of you getting that review are less than 5%. If on the way out you say, oh, and by the way, will you leave a review for us online? But if you make a personal connection with that patient, did you like your experience today, and they're excited, and they know your name, I'm Jimena, or I'm Sean, and you tell them, can you really do me a favor? It helps us tremendously, and my boss really would look favorably on me if you mentioned your name in a review for me online. And they say yes, they will remember they promised you a review, and they have a connection with you, and they liked you, and they want to help you, and it turns into a review. So when you do it that way, the review conversion is much higher. You're much more likely to get a review.
Well, that's where you know everything from is the hospital industry, or the hotel industry. Your dad was a hotelier. I think that
I think
there's such a connection between hotels and the industry that focuses on your experience and, you know, your pillow being fluffed correctly and the good night's sleep. I mean,
oh, absolutely. Clean room. So one of the things that I learned, and this was even before COVID, is the experience, right? Patients come into the room needs to be spotless. My dad used to say in the hotel, there are three things that are really kind of non-negotiables in the hotel. The bed needs to be comfortable. A lot of his hotels are in Florida, so the AC needs to work really well, and the bathroom needs to be spotless. Those are three things. Everything else, they'll let go. But those three things are really important. Bed, AC, spotless bathroom. And in my clinic, I tell my that there is no give on a spotless clinic. You know, you go to a doctor's office and you see some blood on the floor, or you see some blood on the wall, or some dirt on the counter right next to your filler syringes, then what are you gonna think? If I went to a plastic surgeon's office and I saw a dirty office, I would think, are that the instruments they're gonna put inside of me clean? Are they reusing instruments? Are they cleaning these instruments right? What's going on behind the scenes if the parts that I'm actually seeing are this dirty?
That's me with animals. I don't understand how people bring animals to their clinics. I've never understood having a dog in a medical practice. It just shocks me.
Yeah, absolutely. Most basic reason is maybe the patient, another patient in the office has an allergy to the animal, you know? We've learned a lot of tricks along the way to make the patient experience better. We minimize the number. I mean, I get a lot of pushback for this, but I like to do my consultations in a room without anybody else in the room except the MA. I don't like any family members. I don't like any friends there because it's very distracting. We're more than willing to explain the treatment plan and all of that, and I'll take the time to do that after I've done my consultation. But this is a relationship between a provider and a patient, and sometimes when all the other players are out of the room, they really open up about what's bothering them. And so that's another thing I've learned about this experience. Price transparency is very important. So we used to get a lot of phone calls asking for prices. How much do you charge for Botox? And, you know, the typical line was, don't give out the price. Just tell them you need to come in for a consultation. Let me tell you, if there's one way to piss off a patient and tell them that you're a tricky dude and not to trust you, it's to hedge on pricing. I put my pricing out there, exactly what I charge, and we tell them, we can't predict what you're gonna need, but here are some reasonable averages, okay? Saying that you charge $16 per unit of Botox means nothing to a patient, but if you tell them for three areas in the upper face, generally, most of our patients get somewhere between 40 and 60 units. They can calculate that out and know that that's an average and it's they're gonna be okay. So the staff is kind of trained like that. I never give a we have a per syringe price, but we also, when they call, tell them that this is what I see patients getting. The front desk all know that. All my front desk also train as MAs. And the reason is these days patients are calling with such complex questions at the front, and you really need to give them some direction. So if they're not in the room with me seeing the consultations and the questions that are asked in the rooms, they're not ready for the front desk. So everybody that works the front also works the back.
Okay, I love that. Let's stop right there. I think that, I don't know why I haven't thought of this yet. Like, I feel like a dodo bird right now hearing it for the first time. So guys, if you didn't catch that, the MA at the, you know, the person in the room with Dr. Patel is also like the front desk person. They're learning both, because I agree with you. When patients call the front desk, you know, they do their best, right? But they're not in the room with you. They don't hear what you say. But if they keep hearing it over and over again, they see you do it, it sticks, and they can tell, you know, tell the patient a much more methodical answer to the question. But on your website, you have your prices blasting out loud and proud, which I love. You do a lot of things I love. Your name is not on your practice. You have your prices are very public. You know, that's why you're on the show, because you're good. No, but I love the idea that you say.
I listen to the podcast too. I learned from your podcast.
That you say, you know, these are the prices per syringe. Now, are we going to sell it to you per syringe? Who knows, right? We don't know what you're going to get. But I'll tell you, I'm a millennial. I'll own that. I'm, you know, 38 millennial. And if I can't book online and find out your prices, I'm not coming to you. It's not going to happen. If I have to call the next day to get a consult, you know, an over-the-phone consult to see what the prices are or whatever, it's not going to happen. And I think, to your point, it feels very bait and switch. Even a plastic surgeon can say a tummy tuck usually costs X. So if you can quote a tummy tuck like that, you can quote some Botox, guys. It's not different.
Absolutely.
Like, you know, cut me a break here.
But that it was what we were taught early on, right?
Yeah.
To get a consult. And I try to, even on my Instagram videos, I list out everything we do. We say we use 2 syringes of Define, we use the syringe of Contour, we used 200 units of Dysport, 210 of Dysport, we did this and that, and the patient also bought these skincare products. We try to give them an explanation, because so then they're not coming in. I remember I once had a patient who came in for Kybella, and we charged $600 per syringe for a vial of Kybella. And the patient came in, and this was a patient that needed 4 vials of Kybella. And she said, oh, that's $2,400. I was told $600. And clearly, maybe it was a mistake on the part of the staff or somebody, but clearly she was very frustrated and didn't get the treatment done because she was expecting to pay $600. And we were quoting her $2,400. And I would hope that that never happens again, because I have gone on our price sheet and already put in that patients require 2 to 4 vials per session, and they get 2 to 4 sessions spaced apart at 2-month intervals. So you kind of set the expectation. We kind of try to put everything out there. I have this little sheet that goes, it's not a sheet now, it's a 2-pager. That goes out to every one of my patients, both anytime they're coming in for an appointment, and it's what to expect. And it literally has everything that they could possibly ask, or we have been asked, or we have gotten a negative review for. So probably about 2 months ago, I got a negative review because a patient came in for a lip filler, new consultation. We did the consultation. Then I told her that she needed, we could do the lip filler that day, but that she needed numbing. And this was a new lip filler patient. She was nervous. She needed the numbing. We told her we're going to leave the numbing on for about 45 minutes. And she said she was, you know, she had to get back to work. No indication that she was upset, but she had to get back to work and she would make the appointment another day. A couple of days go by and I see a review online, a negative review that we did not explain to her the process when we called. That she took off from work just to come in for this treatment. She had blocked out an hour or whatever, but my consultation takes 30 minutes and then the numbing takes another 30 to 45 minutes. So by the time she would have had what she wanted, it would have been a 2-hour appointment. So we put together this, we added a line into our what to expect, and it's absolutely exactly what they would, they come into the clinic. It says they come into clinic. You're going to be greeted by this person. You're going to go into a photography room. We're going to take photographs. Then you're going to go into a room and the doctor's going to do a consult, which will take anywhere from 20 to 30 minutes. Then the plan will be gone over with you. At that point, numbing may be put on. And then we do the procedure and expect to be here for 2 hours for your first visit. And so we put that in there so we don't get another negative review. We also had to put into that sheet, another example was patients coming in without formal ID, but wanting to use a credit card. When you're paying $3,000 to $5,000 for a procedure and you want to use a credit card, but you don't have an ID. I have a friend who's a plastic surgeon who did some a body surgery, liposuction and a tummy tuck, and it was like $10,000 surgery, and the guy paid with credit card. Just turned out it wasn't his credit card, credit, his care credit. It was his aunt's care credit. And his aunt said she never gave him permission. Of course, care credit's policy is that you got to take a driver's license and get the signature and all of this. His staff didn't do it, and he lost the. There was no. It was not even debatable. He lost the money.
Oh my goodness! So I work with disputes all the time. Obviously, we have a credit card processor inside of AR. Two of them actually. We have two different ones. And we have to talk about this all the time, like getting a signature. I had people today, why do you need a signature? It's no longer required by law because of COVID. I'm like, because if you want to win a dispute, get a signature. A dispute can be won immediately with the before and after picture and a signature. Like, that's a done deal.
Yep, absolutely.
In our charts, we can export all of our things out of our system. It's all connected to one big thing where you can just dump your dispute, you know, responses in there. But I have to tell you, like, these are the things that as a new business owner, when you're starting out, you don't think about because you've never faced that problem before.
Let me tell you, some people don't even know to check for a chargeback. Right? Check, you know, they just debit it out of your credit, your bank account.
Well, you get a static record, you will, because we send you an email and hound you to turn in your dispute responses so that you don't lose your money.
Oh, you guys do. That's interesting.
Yeah, we do, because it's all integrated. So accounts that, you know, for instance, I had an account just this past week, a newer injector, and she had a dispute. It was for $3,000 for a prepayment on a sculpture butt. So a patient puts in, you know, a sculpture butt. And she's calling me in a panic. What do I do? But her invoice disclaimer says you can get a rebate or you can get a credit back if you cancel on your deposit up to 2 weeks before this procedure. And she's like, well, what do I do? I said, well, your disclaimer is what got you because you told the patient you could do it. And so unfortunately in the dispute, they're going to say, well, they're within the policy. So it's like things like that, your invoice policy, whatever the returns, whatever the cancellation policy is, matters tremendously. Like we have a cancellation policy in our system because people don't show up, right? They flake out. Our system charges them $150, whatever it is that, you know, the practice decides because patients get busy. I canceled last night on my lashes, unfortunately, because I had a last minute school function for my son and I happily paid my fee. I'm like, you know what? I canceled on you and you're being paid to be here. And the practice, you know, the lashes, people made no money on me and it wasted your hour. Here's the money. Take it gladly because I messed up, right? I'm the one that's wrong. Yeah, I'm like, take my money. Take it. And they're like, oh, we'll have to charge you again next time for the deposit. I'm like, you know what? That's fine. I screwed up. But when you're brand new to this, because I deal with so many new injectors, obviously on the software side, it's even things like, you know, discounts and how do I handle my samples? And I don't know, you know, when I get Aspire points back and it turns into money, how do I put that on my accounting? Like, how do I account for that?
I will tell you, Aspire was, I know you guys, one of the great things that you guys have done is integrate Aspire. And I don't think, to my knowledge, I don't think any other EMR has done that. And there was a big issue for a long time, even in my practice, every month I personally was checking the Aspires when I was starting out. And I remember I 1 month, it was like $1,000 of Aspire that had been given to the patient, applied to their account, but hadn't been entered into the Aspire website. So Galderma did not know about these points to give them back to me as cash. So patients are getting the $100 Aspire points, but Galderma doesn't know to pay the $100 to me. And if you don't have somebody in your office checking that, you can lose a lot of money on that. If same thing with care credit. If the front desk is running really behind and they enter in your system, if it's not integrated, if they enter in the signature in the system that they paid with care credit, but you forget to report it to care credit, you don't get your payment. So somebody has to do these reconciliations in the practice. And a lot of times when you're starting out, you don't even know that you have to do these things.
Well, I think, you know, as I think about your model, so you're a solo injector, right? You're the only person who's quote unquote practicing medicine in your clinic, but you have infrastructure. So if I'm a new injector starting out, I think about this all the time. And someone says to me, how do you want to grow? Do you add on another person, you know, another medical professional? No, I add on more staff. Because in order for you to do your job well and to be a high efficiency physician, high efficiency injector, you need the person to do Aspire for you, to do the pictures for you, to be the MA in the room, to help the consults with all the questions. Adding another injector doubles that workload, right? It doubles all those needs. So if you don't have, your staff has to quadruple in a sense, if you double the injectors to handle the load. So it's got to be a proportional shift in business. Because to me, I think that the front desk, you know, these people who are helping you, supporting you, they are mission critical, or you would never be able to see the patients that you see as a single person if they weren't doing all that to help you. No chance.
I absolutely, Tiffany. In my clinic, I'll take you through the workflow of how a typical patient, you know, I get in there and my job is to do consults and inject. That's all I do, consults and inject. But there's so much other stuff. So every time a patient comes in or for a follow-up or a new patient consult, they're getting about 10 photographs done. And these are, I'm pretty particular about my photographs. And so it's a tough job. I could see myself getting a full-time photographer in my practice. That's how important photography is to the business. But all the staff is trained on it, and they take care of that. They have to take those 10 photos. They have to upload the 10 photos. Then they have to match them up at the follow-up. They've got to make sure all the paperwork is put in. They've got to make sure that all the paperwork is confirmed with the patient. So if they say they're not pregnant on their form, confirm that they're not pregnant. Getting a full history of what these patients have had done in the past is very useful. Any complications they've had, finding out where they went before, because I want to know why they left that place, because I don't want to make the same mistake they made. The skincare sales is all staff. You know, I give a commission for skincare sales to my staff, because I briefly mentioned skincare in the room, but it's the staff that closes that. And you know, it's actually, quite honestly, I haven't gotten around to giving commissions for injectables, of course, but they're the ones that close that too. I try to go into a room these days, and I think one of the most important things is the provider, the medical provider, nurse practitioner, PA, or physician should not be talking prices and should not even be thinking about finances in the room. And too often, and I'll find that this works both ways. Sometimes you go in there and you think they're going to be shocked when you tell them they need 5 or 6 or 7 syringes and a couple hundred units of Dysport. And so you, because you're thinking financially for the patient, you start recommending less than you actually need. Okay, so that is, in a way, a good thought. You're trying to help the patient out, but you're not really helping the patient out, and you're really hurting yourself, because you're selling something that you're selling a result that you're not going to be able to achieve with what you have told them is required. But my staff, for example, my staff is very astute. Sometimes they'll just add a little disclaimer, because they've been working with me for long enough that if two syringes, they may say in the disclaimer that it's possible you may need 3, but we'll do that at a follow-up. And that's protective staff. That you don't really train that. You find good people and you let them do what they think is right. And I've been very fortunate to have those kind of staff members. And I think the staff is the biggest part of the practice. And I don't think, you know, I'm 8 years into my practice, Tiffany, and I work, unless I'm training, I try to be in the clinic every day of the week. It's my lab, it's where I learn, and it's where I keep up my skills. I don't wanna be, even if I had the opportunity to be on a podium every week, I would think if I'm traveling and I'm tired, how good am I gonna be at this clinically? It should be an honor to speak on the podium, but I don't wanna make it a full-time away from the clinic. There are some of these speakers who I love and I learn a lot from them, but really, when are they seeing patients? And so what are they, when they're telling you something on stage, what is their experience today? Because they're not seeing patients anymore.
Well, I think that's a big thing with like a lot of the legacy trainers. And that was kind of the pushback. And you see the industry starting to shift where they were teaching all day and not practicing. And people started to say in the audience, you know, astute people in the audience saying, well, if you've not injected in the last 5 years because you've been training, how do you know what's new? How do you know the techniques? But they've become like, not robotic, that's not the right word, but they train so much that they can say it as if they believe it. Like, I can give a lecture right now on injecting. I could go in stone cold and deliver a lecture to you on anything in injecting because I wrote all the content. I spent years, months, hours doing it. So I can teach anyone to talk about anything. I could sound like an astrophysicist, so could you if we had to. But I think there's a difference in the passion and the level of, you know, if you're not naturally a great speaker and you're not doing a thing all day, you can't talk about it in the way that people will be convinced by it. So you better be damn good. Yeah, you better be damn good if you don't do it.
You can tell those speakers now. You can tell those speakers. But I thought, I wanted to stress that point you made, Tiffany. I think I get asked this a lot of times by new injectors And they're already thinking about, you know, you're the chief growth officer, so you're always thinking about growth. But, you know, these guys are also always trying to thinking about the next step. And usually what I hear is the next step is getting more and more injectors. And I'm here, I am 8 years into my practice, and I'm the sole injector. And that gets me to start thinking, I think I'm just about ready to add somebody. And that's very important, just about ready to add somebody. Why are these people, there these new practices a year in and they've already got three injectors in there? I think the way to grow is what you said, get the right staff, ticket items. So start spending more time with your patients and educating your patients. Use that rather than spending money on another injector, start getting more staff and get that staff to start taking good photos and get that staff to start educating patients and following up with patients and recalling patients. And maximize what you can do as a single injector before you add in another injector. So that's really good advice, I think. I think too many people are adding too many people too quickly.
Well, I think the secret to scale is to do it once really, really, really well, and then you scale. And I think to your point, if you start on day one, and this is my same thing with like lasers and devices. If you start day one with 10 devices in your practice, no chance you're going to make it with all 10. It's never going to happen. You have no process in place, no flow, no patient retention strategy. You just bought a bunch of stuff and you're hoping that it's going to work for you. So I agree with you. You know, 8 years is a long time. I'll go ahead and tell you that. It's a long time. And by the way, you're a presidential elite account for Galderma. You're a giant injectable account doing it alone, guys. That does not happen. That is not a real thing in real life. Like, it's shocking to me that you can do that much work. But to your point, I think hiring an injector is a big step. It's like when you get married. Like it is basically marriage. We spend as much time at work as we do at home. You are basically married to them, whether you like it or not, or, you know, brother, sister, something, because you're together all the time. And it doubles everything in the practice, doubles the headaches, doubles all the problems, you know. And we had a discussion before we came on the podcast about what if you make the wrong hire? What if you wait 8 years and you hire the wrong person?
Yeah.
That's a
absolutely.
Risk.
And that's what I'm scared of, you know. It's not an easy decision to make, and it's not one that I take lightly. Fortunately for me, I've had some pretty amazing staff members who've gone back to school, and hopefully one of them will come back and work with me because they know my way, and kind of hopefully they're starting from scratch and kind of thinking the same way I do.
Well, and I think even if they don't, you know, if you hire someone who is an experienced injector, and I believe this, if I could tell you what I believe wholeheartedly, this is it, that even if they come into your practice and they are already, you know, injecting all the time, they start with you in the room and learn from you before they inject a patient ever. Because the methods differ so much. As you know, you train people all the time with Galderma, you know, in your own private trainings. The methods from the greats, quote unquote, vary so much. As it goes down from the greats, it gets even more diverse. And so to say I'm a great injector of toxin could mean a lot of different things to different people. So I'm like, I don't care how good you are, you have to start to learn, you know, the Miami skin and vein way, you know, your way. And then you grow and develop. And I think it's offensive for people, but it's nothing to do with you. I don't care if you're Arthur Swift in my practice. I would still say, Arthur Swift, you have to be able to do it my way, because our brand, our patient promise, what you've built for 8 years, retention strategies are built on this methodology. And you've got to fit your circle peg into our square hole, or it's not going to work here. So I think it's a big mistake. We give people freedom to do what they are great at, but it's like, no, you have to still do it. The McDonald's fries are the McDonald's fries, no matter who makes them, you know?
Yep, absolutely. And I thought you made a good point about the devices as well. I've made mistakes on devices. And I think that's another bit of information for somebody starting out a new practice. Do not overcommit to devices. You know, it takes a long time to get really good with these devices. Buy one, and let me tell you, you buy one device and you're probably going to be spending the next 6 to 9 months getting really, really good at it. You don't get good at injectables overnight. You don't get good at those devices overnight either. And I see too many people buying 4 or 5 devices to start a practice with. And that's just mind boggling to me. That's a mortgage right there. That's like an equivalent. You know, some people have this big office rent. You know, you have a big office space, you have big payroll, and then you have this device mortgage, right? These devices are expensive.
And then COVID comes and you're shut down, and how do you pay the bills? Like, that's the thing. If you're the solo guy and your front door shut down and you have all those notes coming due, you had to still pay them. But I think on the device thing, and you may disagree with me on this totally, but here's my thoughts on devices, is devices for me are something that you have when you have patients to offer them to. Like, they're not a calling card. No one says, I'm going to go get a Fraxel. Like, they don't say, I need a YAG in my life. No one says that at home on their couch on Friday night looking at their cell phone, a FaceTime video. They say, my God, I have wrinkles, or, oh, my face looks like it's falling off, or my lips are so small. And I think injectables drive them into a practice because they see, they know it's, I know what it does, right? I know that if I use Botox, my wrinkles go away. If I have cheek filler, my cheeks look better. I think if you're an established practice, at least with a pretty good base clientele, to sell them into a laser makes more sense. Like, we've done your face, it looks amazing. Now let's look at your skin. Look at your dermal thickness. Let's look at, you know, whatever else it is. It's more of a sell-in type device, not a sell-through kind of device. And so I think people get very confused about that. But I think the
I absolutely agree. It's not a gateway.
Correct.
I agree with that. Maybe of all the devices, if there was one gateway, and it's funny, it's the one I don't do, it would be laser hair removal. Okay. Down here, laser hair removal gets people into the office. Problem is, you don't, at least in this market, there's so many people doing it. It's hard to make money on laser hair removal, but it is a gateway. But Fraxel is not going to be a gateway. You're not going to get a gateway. Like you said, nobody knows what a handy YAG is. They may know a blood vessel, and they may not even know blood vessels can be treated with a laser, but during your consultation. But you got to have the patients for something. They have to come in for something else. So, yeah, and then if you have five different devices, how are you going to fit all five of those devices into your routine? It's very easy in a consult to talk about toxins, fillers, skincare, but then you've got to start adding a tightening device, a pigment device, or device. Now there's a device for almost everything. There's a device for sweating. And I know that rep was in my office at Miradry, and I said, how am I going to fit that into my clinic? I'm going to go from consulting on the face and the neck and the chest and to saying, by the way, do you sweat too much? It just doesn't fit in my practice, you know? And I see these people, I mean, that's the problem. You've got to have the patients, and you've got to know what your patient client, what your patient population is. If you're starting out a clinic in Miami and some KOL in Boston told you, you need to start off with an IPL. Well, let me tell you, that's going to be the wrong device to start in Miami, because everybody has dark skin. And you're going to limit your patient base. You need to probably find, if you want to do something for pigment, probably find a fractional laser that you can use on most skin types.
Oh, you just said something that I had on, Katie Lindholm is on our podcast this week that's launching. And she said the same thing, like FOMO, you know, and I see this all the time with even our software. They'll ask me about something like, why do you want to know that? Oh, because so-and-so said it was important. You know, some KOL that I watched in a training last year on stage in Boston, to your point, said it was really important that I have this device. Well, have you ever seen this device? No. You know what it does? No. Do you have a place for it in your business plan? No. But she said, I had to have it. Like, I really got to have it. And I find it's almost like children. I'm like, you want the thing, but you have no idea why you want it, but someone said to do it.
It's a toy.
But I think because this industry is so hard to get into, you know, everyone starts in the industry, they buy, you know, a couple of vials of Botox, they get a few filler, but staying here is very hard. Like, getting here is not hard. Staying here is very, very hard.
Yep, absolutely.
And they're reaching for straws, right? They're reaching for whatever they can find to succeed, because our podcast is about surviving, because this is a hard industry to survive. It's to thrive.
Another mistake patients make, new providers make, is getting these massive places where, you know, the rent is crazy. And, you know, I've learned in, one of the benefits of social media and one of the benefits of digital is that, you know, there's not much walk-in traffic these days. When I was buying, when I leased this place 7 years ago, and now I just bought my own place, but we'll talk about that. That's another thing that I've learned. But when I leased this place 7 years ago, one of the selling points was it's on the first floor, it's retail space, okay? And of course, that has an extra fee with it. What I've learned is nobody walks into first of all, I don't take walk-ins. You got to have an appointment to come into my clinic. Maybe they buy some sunscreen, some skincare when they walk in. But you don't need a retail space for this. People don't walk in. They call. They find me on social media. They find me on YouTube. They find me on Google. They find me on RealSelf. They call, they make an appointment. We give them the directions to our place. It doesn't matter to them if I'm on the first floor or the fifth floor. doesn't matter if I'm in a retail space or in a medical office building. But I would not, if I were doing this again, I wouldn't pay for the extra fee I paid, the extra price I paid to be in a retail place on the first floor on a good street.
But you just bought a practice. You're moving. Tell us about that.
I am. I'm moving about probably 7 minutes from here. I bought it in a medical office building. There are a bunch of plastic surgeons and other injectors. So when I told my dad I'm buying a space in this space, there's a lot of dermatologists and I guess people you would call competitors in there. And I said, but it doesn't really matter because my competition is on the internet, in the digital world. My competition is not who's down the hall. Actually, the place right next to me is an aesthetic place in this current place that I am in. There's a med spa right next to me. And we don't even get his patients walking into our office incorrectly, you know? So what I've learned is it doesn't really matter. The reason I picked that building is it's a really well-run medical building with a lot of plastic surgeons, some of the people that I refer to, a lot of good people in that space, and free parking for my patients. And the most important thing to me was the price was reasonable and there is sunlight in every treatment room, which I love.
Well, I think location matters. I will tell you, this is my gut test on location. If I'm in an area where there is a Lululemon and there's like an Orange Theory, or you have some of those like more kitschy stores, then you know that you're in an affluent enough area to afford your services.
You hit it spot on because you know where my unit is?
Is it next to Lulu? Hopefully.
Right above a Whole Foods.
Exactly. See, and I think it's more for me of like, if the neighborhood can support it financially, then that's all you care about. And to your point, you're competing with the internet. But from a geo-targeting perspective, as you run ads and things, obviously being in an affluent neighborhood is not, or they see your sign walking by,
that is
whatever.
That's the most important, right? That's the most important. Yeah. You got to be in a market where people can afford these treatments.
Which is not everywhere. But, you know, I was in rural Arkansas when I was a sales rep, and you can still build some big practices there because you have to have a much bigger reach. It's much more, you know, high volume, low margin. You're able to do certainly more low volume, high margin. There, to your point in the beginning, pick that. You got to pick, do you want to be a factory, or do you want to spend more time with patients and do a customer lifetime value kind of play, you know, a patient lifetime value play where they're getting lots, to your point, pan facial. These are all decisions that you have to make. And unfortunately, the way the internet works is things never get forgotten about. So whatever you pick today will haunt you in 10 years if you pick wrong.
Absolutely. Like my name, right?
No pressure. But I want to talk to you a little bit about training too, because I think one of the things that I hear, especially from new injectors, and I love this. I love the zest. I love the energy. They start injecting, when I work for Galderma for sure. And within the first 2 weeks, I get asked, how do I become a trainer? How do I get on podium?
Yep, you're absolutely right. And I'm going to tell you, I would be embarrassed to start a training institute if I didn't have the experience that I had. And it takes years of injecting thousands of patients a year to really get good enough to do these live injections in front of a crowd. But really, to do a live injection on a stage is a whole nother story with the lights in your face. It takes a lot. It seems glamorous. And you got to be passionate about it. You got to have a story to tell it or something to teach, right? You really got to, even though, for example, when you're training for the companies like Galderma, it's a very systematic thing. You know, you're on label and you're teaching certain things, but there's still a lot of nuances that you can teach a person. How you, for example, I talk about one of the things that really doesn't get controlled by the FDA is my consultation, and talking about a consultation, anatomy is another thing. So you need to really know these things before you start training. So, you know, while my training sessions are really limited to what, when I'm doing Galderma training, for example, and I love doing Galderma trainings today because they have this massive portfolio now, right? The companies have a massive portfolio and I could treat on a lot of different spots. And I can teach on a lot of, you know, their rheology. There's a lot of science behind this. I was talking about contour in North Carolina recently, and I was asked to give a talk and then do some live injections. And so I was putting together a talk, and I used the slides from Galderma. But what I did was I mixed up a couple of slides from Galderma talks so that, and what I found was, you know, rheology is something that people don't understand. And it took me, Let me tell you, it took me many years to learn rheology, okay? And constantly reading and rereading and using a product and then trying to learn the rheology, reading what the rheology of the product is and seeing how the rheology tied to what I saw clinically. I finally feel comfortable talking about G prime and X strain and how it's measured and how it matters in the face and why we even study these things and what an ideal product is in a specific area. But that's after using all of these products for years. The other thing that I've learned is there are people who train for every company. And I think what's important is you need to really, there are some people who have a practice big enough that they could just train for every product all the time. But in my practice, what I do is I train for Galderma and I use the vast majority of the products I use in my practice are Galderma. And so when I talk about lift and contour and define and refine and when I use lift and when I use contour, there really is a lot of personal experience behind it. And it makes training a lot easier when you're using the products every day. And I wouldn't want to be a trainer very early on in my practice because really, if you're going to do training like anything else in life, you want to do it right and you want to have value added. My favorite thing is to call the rep the day after I've trained and say, well, what's the feedback? You know, and it makes it very rewarding when they think like, oh, that was the best training that they've ever had, they said, and they want to come to you again, or they want to come see you as a patient. It is so valuable, but I wouldn't want to just be a trainer to train. And definitely I wouldn't want to talk about something that I've done maybe 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or even 100 of, right? I mean, to really be talking about toxins and to be talking about fillers and all the potential complications and all the issues that you can run into, you've got to do thousands of these injections.
I agree. I couldn't agree more. And I think too, as a trainer, if you go into practice and you start telling them how to do things, if you're not great at it or buttoned up, you can potentially ruin their practice, right? You can hurt their practice long-term, hurt their reputation. I used to deal with this all the time when I was a sales rep. You know, I watched so-and-so train me and they said this. And it was like, oh my God, don't do that. Whatever you do, whatever they said, you don't listen. But I think that you know, all of a sudden it's not just you that you're impacting. It's other people around you who you're impacting as well. But it's also, you know, could be in some cases gross negligence. There's medical malpractice issues there. Like there's a whole other thing to unpack with all that. But I mean, to your point, I think knowing about the product, understanding it really well is of critical importance, but also having the time to leave your practice and support it. Because when you go away to train, it costs you money because you don't make a fortune, guys. You might think that you do, but you don't. You don't make anything near what you make in a day clinic if you're a busy injector. And it's a lot of headache. But the one thing I do want to say about what you just said, this is interesting, is injecting on stage. So I'm actually doing a workshop at Aesthetic Next about how to inject on camera, how to speak on camera, inject on camera, because what happens is you get on stage, your hands are shaking like crazy. They're in front of the camera. They can't see anything. You've got your big Rolex on, your dangling bracelet. You got your hair down. Women are the worst. We have all this jewelry on. And it's an art form to inject on camera, to show the injection, to appreciate it on camera, to pick the model, how much should you be using? You know, to your point, you don't have time on camera to do 10 syringes. You have time to do 3. And you've got to pick a model who can get you to an appreciable result that is great for the company, right? Because it looks good for Galderma or Allergan, whomever, within 3 syringes, or you can't do it. You know, it's a finite window. So there's so many things to know that I will have to tell you. To become a great on-stage presenter and injector takes years of practice, years of honing your craft, getting your knees cut off because you didn't do a good job. Like, there's a lot of work there.
And you need to know the literature and everything. You need to be able to cite other people's experiences and you need to cite the data and you need to give the behind. I mean, there's so much that you need to do. It is not easy to be a trainer. 2 things you said there. Yeah, there's not, you make a lot more money in a very successful practice. You take a day off from your practice to go train. But you got to really be passionate about it and you got to want to meet people and you got to want to contribute to the field. And I think what training has meant for me is, you know, I'm an encore. I was a former interventional radiologist. But in my prior field, I had been trained at the best programs. And when I came into this field, one of the problems I had was the dermatologists don't want to talk to me. The plastic surgeons don't want to talk to me. I can't go to their meetings. I can barely, I have conversation with somebody that does the same thing as me. And it's very hard to make a contribution to a field like that. And so I had these dreams of one day being able to teach people my techniques and those people going out and saying, I learned this technique specifically for Shaun Patel, or writing an article or working on a research study and then being able to tell patients that, hey, I had access to this product really early on because I worked on this, and on day one, I've treated maybe 200 patients with this product and everybody else hasn't even used the product yet. It's a contribution to the field, which is was very exciting for me. But I certainly take training very seriously for that reason. It's about contributing and contributing good stuff. You want people doing good work out there. If you're not really, if you're doing training just for the glamour, you really don't care about getting them properly, safely trained, you're doing a disservice to the field. The other thing you said there, which was interesting, is picking models. I have learned with these game trainings, it is so hard to pick proper models. I have the reps send me photos of the models now because I've just realized that if you don't get a good model in there, it can be a very bad training. You know, you're training somebody on cheek fillers and you bring in somebody with absolutely no volume, a ton of laxity, a surgical patient, they're not gonna see the power of fillers. You know, we talk about it in my clinic all day. Me and the staff talk about, oh, this is a challenging case, and we try to have fun with those cases. Watch what I can do in this case. This is the power of non-surgical rejuvenation, but this one's going to take me time. Give me some time. Keep the numbing on the other patient for a little longer. These are challenging cases, and those are absolutely the ones that you don't want to bring to training.
And it never fails when they say, well, I have been working on this patient for 5 years and I can't fix this. I brought her today for you to help me. Like, that's the worst patient for training. Terrible patient.
That is absolutely the worst patient for training. That, you know, you want a standard patient, a typical patient, not a challenge patient. And I think if you bring, and so for the people out there who are listening to this and hopefully are some of the newer injectors are going to get trained. When a company gives you the opportunity for training, you don't get many of these because it does cost the money, the company quite a bit of money. And so try to make the best of it. And the most important part is get good patients for your training. If you want to learn lips, get a good lip. I find that in the trainings, the best patients are the panfacial, the patients that I can treat with cheeks, I can treat with nasolabial folds, laugh lines. Now we can treat the chin on label. We can treat the lips on label. Hopefully, pretty soon, I hope we can treat on Sculptra as well.
You'll be able to treat under eyes on label pretty soon.
Yes, I know. I'm excited.
They're launching it. So I mentioned Andreas. They're launching an under eye filler product for a manufacturer that we know quite well in Monaco in a few weeks. So, you know.
Are you going to Monaco?
I'm thinking about it. I got to see if I want to go or not. It's the week after our conference and I'll be a dead animal. You know, I'll be so tired, but.
Oh, wow. That's
who knows?
You're going to be tired.
I do want to say one thing. If you're on my stage, you know, anything I've ever done, gain, aesthetic next, anything, I want you to be a 7. I'm going to put you to a 10. Like, I'm going to take you to a 10. I want you to be a 7 on my stage, because if not, people get so distracted by, oh, she has a big nose. Oh, her forehead's huge. Look at her cheek. Oh, her skin color. Oh, she's got acne. The audience gets so taken aback with these very striking, off-putting features that they can't even see the work that you're doing as the injector. And so I always say, it's not that I'm being not nice or that I'm being discriminatory. It's like, we're not going to see the big picture here of what you're doing if we're focused on the fact that she has a crooked nose that's been broken and never repaired. Like, we're going to focus on the fact that her face is crooked.
Absolutely.
It's facts of life. Facts of life.
And it's the same thing. Yeah. I think not enough emphasis is made on this in the smaller trainings. You know, in the big stage, it's a big production and there are really smart people looking at this. But when I'm going to these trainings, you know, when I was in North Carolina, I did two trainings for contour. And I thought one day was a wash because one was a guy, one patient was a guy, and the other was a patient who had a very heavy face. And you really didn't see the power of the product in either of those patients. But the next day we had two or three beautiful patients that's what they're going to be seeing in their clinic every day. And we were able to get a wonderful training in. And I think they took a lot home. And you know, because they're going to be seeing patients like that every day, they got a lot out of that training. You know, they got a lot out of that training.
And if you're a rep and you're listening to this, it's so important as a rep to pick the right models and to help the practices. Mm-hmm. Because, again, the first practice you went to, the product did not shine, right? Contour did not shine.
Yeah, no,
nor did you, nor did the injector. None of you shone, you know, in that particular training.
Yes, no, and it was actually, I actually told the reps afterwards, we were just having a discussion because they were the same reps for the other often. They're very good reps. They, you know, sometimes you leave it to the trainees, and sometimes you leave it to the trainees thinking that, oh, this is a, you know, somebody very well trained and they should be able to pick, but they're not thinking the same way you are. They may be thinking, oh, I want to really get my mom in for this training so she can get treated by this injector. And you're like, well, but your mom is not the ideal patient for this training, you know? You know, I'd love to treat her, but not for the training, right? Because nobody from this.
Well, I think that we are like way over an hour here. I have no idea, but I'm being told
it's been a lot of fun.
I'm being told that we are, but for the record, you have been a fantastic guest because you love to talk and I love to talk. So we've done a lot of talking today. But you know, I think what you're building is the 8 years without an injector. Like, I think the way that you put things in place, the foundation that you built, is really remarkable. And obviously your practice has grown, you know, tremendously. You're training everywhere. You've achieved some very high levels in the companies with what you're buying. So it's paid off for you in a very big way. And I'm excited to see what happens next for you and to see your new injector whenever he or she arrives. So we're going to follow you on social media.
Well, I'll keep you in touch. I'm going to definitely call you for advice before I anybody in here.
Well, I'm happy to help you with any contracts, guys. Get a good contract for your employees. You know, non-solicitations, non-competes, but give us all your social media handles. We want to watch your Instagram and also your YouTube and your website. How do we find you?
Yep. So I think my website is www.miamiskinandandvein.com. My Instagram is probably what everybody wants to follow. Dr. Shaun Patel, DrShaunPatel. And in YouTube is Miami Skin and Vein.
So we're going to find you in all these channels and watch your videos.
On YouTube, it used to be the Instagram, you put short clips, and YouTube, you put really long clips. And now you can see both on both channels. So
one thing that you said as we part here that I loved was you show the real thing on Instagram and on YouTube, because patients will then find out it takes 6 syringes and it's going to take an hour and a half. So I love the fact that you said that you're kind of raw and authentic. I overly curate and edit everything, but being raw and authentic, I think it's really important. So Dr. Patel, you're doing it right. We're big fans of yours. Keep disrupting and surviving in aesthetics.
Been a pleasure. Been a pleasure.
It has for sure been a pleasure. And I will talk to you very soon. And guys, have a great week. We'll see you next time.
Thanks for listening to another episode of For the Record. This podcast is not intended to provide legal or medical advice. It's for entertainment, education, and information purposes only. For more information on this week's guest or to get started with Aesthetic Record, email us at info@aestheticrecord.com. Be sure to tune in next week for more fresh perspectives on disrupting the status quo and surviving in the aesthetics industry.